Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the iBUG Buzz number 658 for Monday, November 4th, 2024. Can you believe we're already in November? I am Maria, and I will be facilitating this evening. This conference, iBUG Buzz, is an open forum for anyone with questions or issues with their iPhone, iPad, Apple Watch, Apple TV, or HomePod. For anyone who would like to become more proficient in using the accessibility features of these iDevices, and more specifically, we focus on the use of the voiceover screen reader with them, and we also talk about using different accessories along with voiceover like braille displays and headphones, speakers, keyboards, and so on. So welcome to everyone who's joined in tonight live, and to those as well who are listening via the recorded podcast playback. So we have got a lot going on. This is just one of our many events. And to find out everything that we've got going on, you can go to our website to get on our mailing list to receive emails as to what is happening. You can get the podcast recordings, information about our meetings, the Jumpstart Mentoring Program, and other resources. And that is at ibugtoday.org, ibugtoday.org. We have a Facebook group to ask questions during the week in between these calls, and you can find that at facebook.com/groups/iBUG today. So groups, plural. You can follow us on X and on Instagram, and that is at iBUG today. On both of those, all of the recordings of this this buzz and other events like our cafe and Apple workshop and others, the archives of those can be searched by topic on our website. And the podcasts are available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Alexa, or any other podcasting app or platform of your choice by searching for the correct podcast. For example, iBUG Buzz for this event tonight, or iBUG Cafe, iBUG Apple Workshop, and so on. Those recordings are also available on YouTube, and you can find those by subscribing to the iBUG Today channel on YouTube. We also have an iBUG Jumpstart Mentoring Program, as I mentioned in the website preview. So if you are new to the use of iOS devices, you can sign up there as a mentee and be matched with a mentor who will help you one-on-one to get up and running, to learn those fundamental concepts of voiceover that you can then apply to any aspect of your iPhone experience. And of course, if you are quite a proficient, a confident user, and you think you would like to help others and share what you know, we welcome you as well to fill out our mentor applications, our mentor application. And again, both of these can be found on our website at ibugtoday.org. And so we have many events that go on throughout the month, of which this is just one, and all of our events happen on the same Zoom line. So this upcoming week, so we are here at the iBUG Buzz, and this goes from 7 to 9 p.m. Central Time. So all of these timings will be in Central Time. Then tomorrow on Tuesday from 5 to 6 p.m. Central Time, we have our Mac Buzz. So it's like this, but it's a free Q&A help session with anyone who has Mac OS and Mac hardware accessibility questions and issues. Then staying just a couple of days after that, this upcoming Thursday, we have our iBUG Trekkie Talk, where we meet to, we watch ahead of time, and then we meet to discuss episodes of Star Trek. And right now we're in Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and we will be discussing season 2, episodes 10 and 11. And that will be this Thursday from 8 to 9:30 p.m. Central. Then this, continuing this week, we have on this upcoming Sunday, we have our iBUG Cafe. And so this will be this upcoming Sunday, 10th of November, from 4 to 5:30 p.m. Central. And this is an opportunity. This is a deep dive. And again, a free training session, a deep dive covering a certain app in detail. And this month, we will be looking at the Amazon app on the iPhone. These are just some of the events that we have going on throughout the month. And so, of course, invite you to visit our website and subscribe to our list to find out more. After tonight's buzz, so after the 9 p.m. Central time, we're going to have our After Buzz segment. And so this is an opportunity for you all. This is where we as facilitators go away and you all get to talk about whatever you would like to talk about other than religion and politics and technology. And so that is a great way for all of you to get to know each other without us being in the way. So all iBUG services are free. There are no membership dues or fees. And so we hope you will join us. And so with that, we will now go around the room, the virtual room that is, to introduce ourselves and where we are from. So I am Maria, and I am from Albany, New York. And in one moment, I will invite you to unmute yourselves to tell us your name and where you are from.
Hey, Maria, it's Raheel, and I am from Albany, New York, and I've definitely maybe seen you on Friday at the ACB meeting.
All right, welcome, Raheel, in Albany as well. All right, who else would like to say hello?
This is Herbie in Houston. When are you going to come visit us over here?
Well, that's right. All right. And who else would like to say hello? I think I heard someone else too.
Liz from Fort Worth.
Liz. Welcome, Liz.
Joanne from Pennsylvania.
Hey, Joanne. Welcome.
Pat from Ohio.
Hey, Pat.
Ed from Georgia.
Bridget from Atlanta.
Hey, both of you from Ed and Bridget, welcome.
Thank you.
I'm Tammy from North Carolina.
Hey, welcome.
Hello, Bo Houston.
Hello, welcome, Julie.
John from Austin.
Hey, John, welcome.
Gary and
Dawn
Austin.
From Houston.
Hey, Gary and Dawn, welcome.
Cheryl Reno.
Cheryl from Austin. Hello to both of you. Welcome.
Joe from Toronto, Ontario, Canada.
Hey, Joe. Welcome.
Hi there.
Debbie from Arizona.
Hey, welcome, Debbie. Anyone else would like to say hello to unmute and tell us your name and where you're from?
Dan from Kansas.
Hey, welcome to you both.
Dan from Southern California.
Hey, welcome, Dan.
Brad, I'm in Dallas.
Welcome, Brad.
This is Dee from up here in Illinois.
Hello, Dee from up there this time, Illinois.
Jody in New Hampshire.
Hey, welcome, Jody.
I'm Marie. Hi, Dee.
This is Kelly Ontario.
Hello, welcome to you both. Anyone else like to say hello?
Elizabeth from Newfoundland.
Hey, Elizabeth, welcome.
Hi.
Roy from Fort Worth, Texas.
Hey, Roy, welcome.
Thank you.
And I heard someone else.
Hi, this is Rosetta Stone from Conyers, Georgia.
All right, welcome, Miss Rosetta Stone.
Thank you.
Anyone else like to say hello? All right. Well, welcome to all of you. Happy to have you here. Just to check in case, do we have any first-time callers this evening?
Tiffany is the first time.
Hey, well, all right. Well, welcome, Tiffany. So how did you hear about iBUG?
Social services.
Very good. And what kind of iDevices do you have, and how long have you had them?
I've got a Do what?
What kind of device do you have?
I got an iPad and an iPhone.
Aha. Uh-huh. Okay, very good. And have you had them for a while, or are you quite new?
I've had them a long time.
Okay, beautiful.
But new to the program.
Yeah,
absolutely. Well, welcome. Happy to have you here.
Thank you.
All right. Any other first-time callers? All right. Beautiful. Well, welcome, everyone, whether for the first time or welcome back. So with that, we will go ahead and start the questions for this evening. So who'd like to get us started with the first question or comment? You can say your name, and I will acknowledge you. Feel free to unmute to say your name in order to ask your question or give your comment. If you've had any new apps that you have tried or any issues that you've had with recent update, I know iOS 18.1 came out quite recently.
Joe, I have a question.
All right. I think I heard you first.
Yeah. Thank you.
Go ahead.
I've noticed when I am in an edit field and I'm typing something that, like, one example is Facebook and there are others. When you go to send it, if you go past it, you finish writing what you're going to do, and then you go to where you send, and then if you go past it by mistake, there's a whole bunch of list of words. I don't understand what those words are doing there.
Ah, okay. So you're talking about the words that are, like, if you're just continuing to flick to the right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Who would like to talk about those words, those changing words? Rahiel, go ahead.
So just to clarify, what do you mean that there's a bunch of words? Like, I know on the keyboard, there's like UIOP, whatever.
No. There's words. Yeah. There's words. I don't know how to explain it. Sure, I think I'm talking about, I'll let you do it.
Yeah. So I think you're talking about, Joe, so there are the words that show up basically above those letters of the keyboard. Correct? Mm-hmm. Like, if you're touching on the screen, they're above all of that. So, like, as you're flicking to the right past the send button, then you're coming to words. Yes, go ahead, Hervey.
I think what you have enabled is predictive text.
Okay, but those words are, why are they showing up there and not when I'm typing? Like, this is way past, you know, this is like when you go, I don't see them unless I've passed the send or post button, and then they show up. Why am I seeing them there and not when I'm typing?
Yeah.
All right.
You might want to turn.
Okay, hang on one person at a time. I think Hervey, let's go with you first, and then I'll come back to you, Rahiel.
So first of all, have you looked to see if they actually do also appear above the letters?
I'm using Braille screen input, so I wouldn't know.
Using Braille screen. So first of all, this is Hervey.
Yes, go ahead, Hervey.
Sorry. Okay, so sorry, Rahiel, I'm not trying to interrupt you, but I'm trying to work with you here.
With
Braille screen input, first of all, a trick is you don't even have to get out of it to find the send button and all that. You can actually just do a three-finger swipe up, and that'll send your message without even having to hunt for it. So just a neat little trick there in case you weren't aware.
Well, depending on what app you're in, it won't do that for Facebook, and it won't do it for another forum I'm on.
Facebook, no. Okay. No, Facebook, no. That's a whole other animal altogether. And
Apple Viz doesn't do that either. So I have to swipe over.
Go ahead, Maria.
Correct. Yeah. So the three finger, and we'll just come back to your question very shortly. So the three finger swipe up is something that currently at the moment seems to work in messages only. So then we'll come back to in terms of the predictions on the screen. I think, were you going to, did anyone have a further, I think, Hervey, were you going to be making a comment about accessing the predictions in Braille screen input? Is that where you were going?
Well, this is Hervey. I'm not quite sure if it's something in Braille screen input or if it's something that Facebook does, because they've made so many little changes now that I'm going to acquiesce to somebody else's wisdom on this. Just real quick.
It's not just Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Let's see if anyone has any comment here as to these predictions and how they can be accessed in Braille screen input. All right. So I All right. So a suggestion that that I have, you might want to try when you're staying in Braille screen input is that you might want to try a one finger swiping up and down, I believe it is, that it should take you between word predictions, and then flicking to the right with the one finger should insert them. Are you saying, Joe, like when you're still seeing these words, are you in Braille screen input? Are you in the command mode and where you're just pressing the dot four, right?
Either that, or I've gone into, or I've stopped it and there's some swiping. Yeah.
And so when you've stopped that, or when you are moving to the right in Braille command mode with the dot four, are you seeing the on-screen keyboard as well? Are you seeing those letters as well, the Q, W, E, R, T, Y, and so on, if you keep going?
No, but I am seeing, if I keep going, I'm seeing a group of words that I don't need anymore, because I've already finished what I'm writing, so it doesn't... It doesn't stop and tell me if I've made a mistake. So those words don't mean anything to me.
And are you seeing these words before you hit the send button, correct? After. When you're still in. Oh, I see. So like it's no longer, is the text field in, is it still in edit mode? Like if you go back. Okay. Okay, so that may be why that is happening. If that predictive feature is enabled, it might be trying to give you predictions to start typing as to what you might want to begin typing. Yeah, because it's still in edit mode. The way that you would probably need to, back out of that screen in order, and then, maybe come back into it, but to kind of disable the editing, and then those keyboard features should go away. So it sounds like that's still part of the word prediction.
Okay, so the word prediction only really works if you're typing on the regular on-screen keyboard, then I take it.
Well, it works in that way when you're typing on this, the on-screen keyboard. As I said, with your Braille screen input, and if someone else, feel free to chime in, because I am not recalling at the moment what the exact gesture is, but I want, it may be when you're in Braille screen input, the one finger, right, the flick up and down to move between your predictions.
But it doesn't tell me about the word prediction. If I make a mistake, I don't hear anything. I don't hear that there's a mistake.
I see, you're autocorrect. Okay, go ahead, Herbie.
I used to use autocorrect when I did standard typing, and then I turned it off when I started using BSI because I found it not helpful, kind of like what you're describing.
Okay.
I don't know if autocorrect actually, because it's a different way of inputting text, I honestly don't know. This is something that might need to be investigated more, if there is a way to get autocorrect and predictive text to work with BSI.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Very good. Thank you. Anyone? Yeah, that is what it sounds like. Yeah, I've turned off the autocorrect as well. And because I don't think the text isn't being translated until you either press this, do the flick to the right for like a space, or the two finger flick to the right for a new line, or you can do the three finger flick I don't remember now what the gesture, but there is a gesture to manually translate. Right. So yes, go ahead, Rahil.
So you go into settings and keyboard and turn off autocorrect. Is that right?
Yeah, I'm thinking about doing that. Thanks.
Yeah,
I thought it would be handy. I might.
This is Herbie.
All right. Go ahead, Herbie, and then I think we can shift from this. Yep. Yes. Go ahead, and then we can. All right. I'm not hearing the comment. All right.
This is Herbie. I got a thing saying my internet was unstable, so I don't honestly.
Yes,
don't
we did not hear you.
Okay. I was saying, telling Raheel, yes, go into settings, keyboard, general keyboard, and then turn off autocorrect and all that. Yes.
Settings, general, and keyboard.
Yeah, got it. Okay.
And and autocorrect. Yep, and keyboard autocorrect. All right, very good. Thank you. Great discussion there. Great question. Who would like to ask our next question?
This is Marty.
I think I heard, was it Dawn? I heard someone actually.
Yeah, Dawn.
Yes, Dawn. Yes, go ahead, and then Marty will come to you. Yes, go ahead, Dawn.
I've took a picture before, but if I screenshot a document, how do I email it to someone?
Raheel?
All right. Go ahead, Raheel.
So once you take the screenshot, right? So you take the screenshot, you can go, if it goes away and if you don't have time to react, you can go into your Photos app and then go all the way down to where you have it, screenshot. You have a screenshot, and then you could go in there, double tap on that, and then you want to double tap share, and then mail, and then you can compose it to whoever you need to compose it, type in the subject line and type in the body, like here's the screenshot of this, and then double tap on send.
All right.
Okay, so I have to do that in Photos or camera?
In Photos.
This is Herbie.
All right, very good. Yes, go ahead, Herbie.
Just a personal recommendation. I honestly recommend going to the camera and doing it from the camera roll just because it displays things in the order that you first took the pictures. So like the screenshot will be the very first thing you come to if you do it right afterwards or if you don't take any other photos between when you take the screenshot and you go to the camera. So I personally recommend you go to the I personally find it easier to access photos from the camera roll myself. So for that reason, because it displays things in chronological order.
This is Jody.
All right. Jody, go ahead.
Yeah, I agree with Herbie completely. I go to camera and then in the lower left-hand corner, there's photo and video viewer. And when you tap on that, it brings up the last image that you took to put to your photos. And that's so much easier than trying to go through photos. So I agree with Herbie and then you just go down to the share sheet at the bottom of the page on that one.
All right. Anyone else?
Thank you, guys.
All right. Very good. Thank you. So, yes, there are multiple ways for sure of doing these things. And, yes, with the Photos app and iOS 18 got definitely a bit of a redesign where things there's just one big grid and you kind of have to find different categorizations to find things more easily. But whichever works for you, that's what matters. All right. Very good. All right, Marty, now we're coming to you.
So in my email, when I'm in the main top level of my email boxes. This is an iOS email. Mm-hmm. It used to say like, you know, would have mailboxes heading and then the first thing would be all inboxes. And then underneath would be like iCloud, AOL and drafts and all that. But for some reason, I don't know what I did, but it's iCloud, then all inboxes. And then AOL. So all in boxes is not the first thing. And I went into edit and I see some, it says reorder, but it says something about double tap. And when you hear a sound and drag, is there another way to put that up to the top?
All right. Does anyone have any comments here? Another way of reordering? All right. So yeah, Marty, I guess I will say not. It does not appear that there is another way in this particular screen. In some other places in iOS, I can't think of an example off the top of my head, but there are places where there's the actions rotor and you'll be able to move items up one at a time and such as an alternative. But that is not the case on that screen. There's not a an actions rotor item. So you will have to, what you're going to just do is you're going to touch over there to the right. And then when you double tap and hold, it's for about like 3 seconds or so. And as you, it is accessible. So as you then drag your, and remember, you don't actually have to have your hand right on the button. You don't have to have your finger right on that location. As long as VoiceOver is focused on it, you can double tap anywhere on the screen then. As soon as VoiceOver focuses. So you can, for example, double tap then in the lower part of the screen. And then as you drag, as you move your finger up, you will be told by VoiceOver, like moved above this. So you would want to then, you know, move it above, for example, your iCloud versus below the iCloud where it is now. So it doesn't sound like it would be too much of a dragging movement, but that is accessible in terms of reordering it.
So this is Marty. So I double tap and hold, and then once there's a sound, then I can start the dragging? Because it said something about wait for a sound.
Yeah, so this is basically, so if you're using, if you have your voiceover sounds enabled, it's basically like the sound, the regular double tap and hold sound. Like if you are needing to double tap, it's like the ascending tone. Like it goes higher. It's like a three part, like do, do, do. And then once you hear that, yes, then you can start dragging and you'll even hear little like pings, like little pops. And it'll then tell you like moved above this. So it's definitely inaccessible. And like I said, it only sounds like you need to drag from what you said, maybe drag it up one. So hopefully it shouldn't be too much of a challenge.
And do I drag it? This is Mari. Do I drag it by going to the left or actually going up?
Up. Yep. You're actually going to go up. You're moving vertically. Yeah. Cause they are laid out in a vertical list. Right. So yes, you actually, you physically, you want to drag it, if you will, up above your iCloud so that it's at the top.
Okay.
And then you can select the done button and you should hopefully be all set.
Yep. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Very good. Good question. All right.
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Jerry from Vermont. Go ahead.
I have a little bit of a problem. I have a 15, an iPhone 15 Pro, and I'm on the 18.1 thing, what used to happen was I used to be able to move folders and files with, you know, I hold and it would say drag. And I would, double tap on drag, and it would talk me through the whole process. And when it said drop complete, the drop would be complete. But now I'm not able to do that anymore. I don't know what I've done something in settings or what I've done, but it may be broken until the next update. But does anyone have any issue? Has anyone else had that?
Yeah. Who did I just hear?
Liz.
Yes. Go ahead, Liz.
Yes, it's broken.
Yes, it is.
Sorry, but it's broken.
Indeed. Yes. Thank you, Liz. Yeah. It. And I invite you, Jerry, too, on the newly returned Apple Viz. They do tend to have on their blog, to the extent that they, as a small team, can identify bugs. They do have a post on iOS 18.1, and yes, that is what they mention. I forget if they classify this as serious or how they classify it, but they do mention this bug. So yes, indeed.
Thanks.
Yes, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. This is Jerry again. I had to, do the old wait for the sound, and I was able to get one thing to happen, but it's complicated if you're not going more than one or two spaces, because you don't, and it's not talking, so it's not saying
where
you are or anything. So it's kind of complicated.
No, absolutely. Yes, and I would invite you, first, I would invite you to reach out to accessibility@apple.com. The more people who reach out to them, the more numbers they have of reports. Hopefully, they will prioritize it more quickly. Yes, in Apple Viz, they are pointing this out in the context of moving apps into folders. But certainly, the rotor option, using it on the actions rotor, that items get placed in the position before the folder instead of going, into the folder and such. But again, it's inconsistent and it's not quite working as expected.
This is Marty.
All right, go ahead. Okay, yep, one more. We're going to Marty first, and then we'll come to Rahil. So.
Jerry, if you're moving apps, don't you do the way, like, in other words, you go into edit and then you flick up to drag and then... You click on drag, and then you go to where you want to put that app, and it will say either drop in the folder or drop before. And then when you are where you want to put it, you just double tap, and then it said drop ready or something like that, and you double tap, and it's there.
That's exactly what I used to do, but now when it does it, I do it that way, and it says drop complete, and it's before the folder. It's not in the folder.
Exactly. It's not in the folder. Yep. And that's this exact bug. Yep. That Apple Viz is. Yeah. So it's broken. That is how it's supposed to work, Mordy. That's great summary. But yeah, right at this very moment in iOS 18.1, it is broken. Rahil, you were going to make a comment.
Yeah. What about calling Apple Accessibility, and then they could do like a screen share, like a whatever they do, like screen share, and then they walk you through it that way.
This is Herbie.
Yep. You can certainly, I mean, calling them is another way in terms of them being able to see the bug, you know, happening, to be able to reproduce it on their end, or you can certainly email them to Herbie. Yes, go ahead.
I was going to say the same thing, but this question brought up another bug that I'm thinking other people have experienced too, and that is the lack of audio ducking. Or am I the only person that even uses that feature and so nobody else has noticed? Liz?
All right, Liz, go ahead.
Yes, Apple just gives you all of this wonderful information. That's broken too. It's not working.
Yes, the post is saying, audio ducking. There's a comment, actually. This came from a comment about audio ducking not working. So that wasn't in the Apple Viz post itself, but it certainly was in these comments that it doesn't, this person is saying they have it on, but it doesn't do anything, and it worked in 18.0.1. And someone else here is saying as well, at first, someone is saying that at first they thought that it didn't work either, but then they found that they had to readjust the voiceover volume while it was on, which fixed it, which I don't quite, that wasn't detailed enough for me to quite understand what they meant.
Maybe re-adding the voiceover volume into the, go ahead, Pete.
In the road, potentially. Pete, go ahead.
I came in late and I apologize, but I gather that Apple Viz is acknowledging a bug in the audio ducking feature. Because I did a bite on this a couple of weeks ago when I hosted this buzz, and now I find that because you can select one of two settings, actually one of three. You can turn it off, the ducking, or you can set it to all, always, or you can set it to when speaking. And I have found that the all setting does not work at all. And then I had to go in and turn the voiceover up to 199%, which is the maximum. And then I was able to distinguish the voiceover from the background music. But otherwise, it was as if it wasn't even working at all. So I guess I would confirming that.
All right.
I don't know if that makes sense.
Yes, it does make sense. Yeah, thank you for confirming that. So yeah, definitely reaching out to Apple to report all of these. Mm-hmm. Pat, go ahead.
I was going to say I agree with both of those bugs. They are ridiculous.
Yes.
This is Marty.
Go ahead, Marty.
What I found was because I had that problem with SiriusXM. So when I went into the audio ducking, I had it on when speaking, but for some reason when I did the update, voiceover volume was down to 50. And so then I upped it to about 150, and it was a little better, because at first I could not distinguish the music was louder than way louder than voiceover.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to change the voiceover volume.
Thank you for clarifying that.
This is Pete, and I want to concur with Marty, except that's when I said I had to turn it up all the way to the max, because even 150% wasn't really a discernible difference. Yeah, the music in the background was really, really loud.
Joe. So thank you for confirming. I think that is what the Apple Viz then commenter meant by that. So that is helpful. Yes, Joe, go ahead.
I found when I do that, voiceover is blowing my eardrums out, and the music is where I want it. The voiceover is too loud.
Yeah, it's definitely a ballot. I would invite you, if you'd like, you can add a volume item in your rotor.
Yes,
and that is your voiceover. Yes.
Yes, that's what I've already done, and that's where I'm doing it from. But it seems that in order to balance it so that I can hear voiceover over the music and have the music turned down, voiceover is way too loud.
Mm-hmm.
Even when I'm finished with audio ducking, it's still too loud.
Right.
I don't need it at 190% everywhere, you know.
No, absolutely. Who was I just hearing?
I think it was Pete.
This is Pete. This is Kenny. Yeah, I've got a fresh question.
Okay.
Whoever that is could go first.
Yes, I didn't catch who was at the same time as Pete. Who?
Sorry. This is Kenny.
Oh, Kenny. Yeah. Yes, go ahead.
Kenny. Yep. With the advent of the Apple Intelligence, what is everyone's favorite AI app?
Rahil?
All right. And just to clarify before we shift to you, Rahil, are you asking Kenny like your favorite Apple Intelligence feature?
Oh, I didn't know they had features. I just got it today and started messing with it.
In terms of like, you're asking like where do people use it, right? Like kind of what are its capabilities like?
Oh, yeah, that's a great question. Yes.
All right. Then Rahil, go ahead.
So I like both mail and notes and messages. I like the writing tools where you could do the friendly text messages and professional and proofread and rewrite. I never use the rewrite feature. Mostly I've been playing with friendly text messages.
This is Herbie.
Right. Go ahead, Herbie.
So the AI I've been playing with is Google Gemini. And I really, one of the things I like, because you can write to it or talk to it, and I could ask it a lot of interesting questions. And one of the uses I found for it is information on the products in the kitchen. So like the other week I had a frozen dinner. And I could get to seeing AI to scan so much, and I was like, okay, I can keep playing around with the barcode, or I can actually ask this AI here, what are the cooking instructions for P.F. Chang's honey chicken? And it'll probably tell me, and it did. So
excellent. All right.
And I also found out that it would actually give more information on calories and stuff, because Chanel had also tried something like with the ChatGPT, like getting some calorie information, and it was a little bit more referred to the product packaging, whereas Gemini, I asked it the same information, and it gave me like all the details. So I think there are some differences with the different AIs.
Hmm. All right, very good. Joe, excuse me. I think Joe, that was you, yeah. Was next.
Yeah, yep. I had heard that you could get that with iOS, but when I tried typing it in the App Store, I didn't find it. So maybe I'm spelling it wrong. And could somebody help tell me how to find it?
All right. And this is Gemini, correct? Yeah. You're looking for?
Yeah, I was looking for Google Gemini, and I spelled Gemini, G-E-M-I-N-I.
All right.
Because that's the way I'm...
That's the way, yeah, you would think. Anyone have any... What did you all search to install Gemini?
This is Herbie.
Yes, go ahead, Herbie.
So Gemini came up for me when I launched the Google app one day. It was like, hey, do you want to try our new AI Gemini? And I was like, okay, why not? So I told it yes. So,
okay.
Now when you open the Google app, there's two search options. By default, it's still in its default search thing, but you can then switch to search with Gemini. So that's how you determine, once you tell it yes, you want to use it, that's how you can determine the two different aspects of Google. So
thank you.
All right, very good. So just search Google, it sounds like, then.
Yeah, Google app, the Google iOS app.
Oh, yep. Okay, I don't have that. I'll have to put that in.
Yeah, just all download that from the App Store. And then in my case, I just opened it and it asked me if I wanted to try Gemini. So, and I told it yes. So.
Very good. All right. Anyone else have thoughts on AI? Anyone who hasn't spoken yet? John, go ahead.
Hi, everyone. This is John from BC, Canada. My apologies for not being able to introduce myself. But yeah, I just thought I'd break things down just a little bit. So, of course, there are different kinds of Apple Intelligence we've been covering, like Google Gemini, ChatGPT. Of course, Apple has their partnership with ChatGPT, but of course, Apple has the hardware requirements like 15 Pro and up, and they have the software components. But I just wanted to kind of chime in, because I don't know if any of you have listened to Double Tap with Stephen and Sean. For seeing AI, apparently there's now audio descriptions for videos. So when you record a video, it'll include an audio description with, I'm guessing it uses either voiceover or some sort of speech synthesizer, because it's like, it doesn't sound like a natural human voice, but it's cool because it seems to work well enough. Like, I mean, they did a demo on Double Tap in which he played a couple of videos, and he knew that the audio description was correct based on, like, I think he, at the time, he knew what was going on in the video in advance. So that was why he was able to play it back for the viewers and confirm the accuracy of the audio description.
This is Pete.
Go ahead, Pete.
Just wondering, John, what kind of videos did they use to sample? Was it something they pulled off YouTube, or was it a homemade video, or?
This is John. Yes.
Yes, go ahead.
He was using homemade videos, and he was using them in MP4 format. So it doesn't seem like you can do live videos, but you can share from your library, and it describes them with the synthetic speech.
All right. Very cool.
Use a YouTube video.
Hmm.
Because sometimes you pull those off and they're not self-explanatory.
This is John.
Right. Yes, go ahead, John.
Assuming it doesn't conflict with copyright restrictions, I would think that would be possible, and it would also be pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you for sharing that. Yeah, these AI, they keep improving. I will have to try that. I know I tried with the Pixie bot before a description, and I think it only described like 30 seconds. This was a video that I'd taken on my phone, and I knew that it was okay because, you know, I had someone cited explain to me, and there definitely were some errors in what that AI said. So I will be interested to see what it is like now with seeing AI. So thank you for sharing.
This is Deb.
Deb, go ahead.
Yeah, I actually just earlier today, I was open to seeing AI to use something with, you know, the short text or whatever. And it must have updated the version of it, because there was right there on the home, you know, when you first open it, there was a thing that described that. You know, like it had just updated the app probably. And so there's a description there, at least on my phone, there was a description of that video capability now.
Oh, so. Thank you for that. Yes. Yes. When seeing AI updates, actually a lot of apps, I've noticed this from Apple as well, after an iOS update and such, you'll get these screens that come up that say, what's new in? And then it'll give you the app, the new features, and you have to click done or continue or something like that. So that is a very good point. So yes, if your app, if your auto update, if you've disabled automatic updates, then you'll want to manually update seeing AI to get this functionality. But otherwise, it should update. All right, very good.
This is Todd with a new question.
I didn't catch who that was that said with a new question.
Dot.
Dot. Yes, go ahead.
Okay. Since I updated my iOS to 18.1. I cannot for the life of me put my phone app on the dock like I used to.
So I'll invite you to review the recording, Dot. We actually talked about this earlier today. There is, the ability to drag your apps where you want them is currently broken in iOS 18.1.
Oh, okay.
Indeed. So it is not
I
just
missed
you.
It. Okay.
Yeah. That's okay. I invite you to report that to Apple, because the more people they hear from, the quicker they will fix it. All right. Very good.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yep. I think we got his little cue going. I think before whoever that was who said with a new, I think I had heard Jody. Oh, Rahil, let me just come back to you. I think I had heard Jody with a new question.
Put Pete in your cue, too.
Oh, Pete. Oh, yes. Thank you.
Yeah, I just have a question about the seeing AI feature. When you have the video in your photos gallery, do you then go to the share sheet and go to more and go to seeing AI in order to get the description for that? Is that how that works?
All right.
This is Deb.
Yes, Deb, go ahead.
I know I'm the head of these other people, so I'll make this real quick. All I know is what it said in the thing that I read earlier, and it said browse your gallery and pick the video that you want to share and share it to to that. So, yes, that's what I would guess.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, very good. And actually, Pete, I think I'd heard you before as well. So let's go to you, and then Rahil, you'll be next question after Pete's question. So Pete, go ahead.
Yeah, I had a new topic, cool. Yeah, I was checking the iBUG Today Facebook group over the weekend, or actually earlier in the week, and this question was posed. And I wasn't really familiar with this term, but somebody came on and said, does anybody know how to send a blind text message to a messaging group? And I clarified that because I hadn't heard the term. And I said, what do you mean by blind text message? And the person said, it's when you can direct your response on a text group to a single recipient. Instead of, say, your group has five people in it, but Maria, you're one of five people in the group, but I just wanted to send the message to you by sending it to the group. And I've never heard that term and was completely baffled. Does anyone have any thoughts of, or have you ever heard the term a blind text message?
All right. And or how to, I guess, do that within the group. Yes, go ahead, Herbie.
I know you can reply to a person by swiping down. But everybody in the group sees it, but they know that you're replying to them and they can see what message you're replying to.
Yeah, it kind of set, this is Pete.
Yes, go ahead.
And then that kind of sets it up as an offset message, not a regular message in the group, but you still see it as a message within the group, though. I think I know what you're talking about. Yeah. Okay, I hadn't thought of that one. Thank you, Herbie.
All right. Anyone else on this?
I had another thought as well, if I could kind of close it up. Sure. You can also go to the top of your messages screen and flick once from the top left element, flick once to the right, and you get the name of the group or one of the phone numbers in the group. And then you can open up the conversation details, I think it is. And then you can go to each individual member of the group and send them an individualized message privately. But I'm not sure if that's what this person was referring to. So I was just wondering if anybody had heard that term, a blind text message, and apparently not. And that's cool.
All right. Thank you. Yeah, I hadn't heard of it either. And the only other thing I can think is you can do a mention, like typing, you know, the at sign in someone's name. But again, the whole group sees that, and that's not a private. So, I think we've covered well the basis as to what you can do. So,
excellent. Right. Thank you.
All right. Very good. Good question. Thank you. All right. Rahil, I think you were next to the question.
So apparently I use the Planet Fitness app to check a guest in, or I use the Planet Fitness app to go to where I need to go to get my attendance history. So apparently it's putting the refer a friend at the top of the screen. What was that? Sorry.
Okay. No worries. Go ahead.
It's putting the you can refer a friend at the top instead of the button that says person. And I don't know what kind of gesture you have to do with four fingers downward to get the button that says person, but the label is not labeled in, and it's harder to report to Planet Fitness. And they're like, oh, I'm sorry, you know, yada yada, my apologies. And then they don't have an option for help under the app. Like, they have an help, but like, they don't have an option for reporting that thing for the app with voiceover.
An accessibility challenge. Yeah,
so how would I go about accessing the person's area to get my attendance history for me to get reimbursed monthly?
All right. Does anyone use this app and or have a general idea? It sounds like certain elements on the screen are not coming. And so how to scroll perhaps back over to the top, or how to access some inaccessible elements perhaps. Does anyone have any thought?
Pat,
go ahead.
They usually have something. If you go to the app store under that app, they should have contact information in there. They may have an email or whatever that you can send something to.
Yeah, they don't. They don't.
All right.
This is Shree.
Go ahead, Shree.
Did you try turning on screen recognition and see if it picks it up?
Yes, but even though it's screen recognition on, it still says you can refer a friend for blank whatever at the top. What's at the top for some reason?
This is Shree.
All right. Go ahead, Shree.
So the double tap is not working. Is that's the issue?
No.
Yes, Rahul, yeah, if you can explain. So the issue appears to be that there used to be a control at the top through which his profile could be accessed, but that doesn't appear to be present or just doesn't appear to be accessible with VoiceOver if it is on the screen there at the top.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. All right. Anyone else have any thoughts, any suggestions?
Yeah, because I tried to contact them.
Yep. All right. Well, I guess the only thing I can think is maybe you were saying about scrolling that three finger flick down, and then if it's a refreshed screen, perhaps if that helps, exploring by touch up there then in the left and right corners. And if you're not able to get it to work, then perhaps just maybe going on their website via a contact us form, you might be able to get somewhere there in terms of like website or app feedback, something like that.
Okay.
To reach the right people. So good luck with that. We can all definitely relate to the frustration of inaccessible apps, and I hope that gets fixed for you. All right.
This is Shree.
Shree, go ahead.
So I have a good question about Be My Eyes.
All right. And
my question is, you know how you can add a family member to be as one of the sighted volunteer in your group?
Mm-hmm.
So I invited my wife, but at her end, she doesn't really see anything. Is there something that I need to do? Like, I invited her, I sent her a text message, she got the text message, she signed in to Be My Eyes. Is there something else that she needs to do to become part of the individual group that I created?
All right. Does anyone have any experience with this feature of Be My Eyes?
This is Thomas in Colorado.
Thomas, go ahead.
Nope, actually, that's all there is to it, is once they sign up, then when you go to your groups and you click on whatever you named your group, then you make the call, it should come through on her phone. So it's simply selecting your group, and then once you do that, then it'll ask you to connect, and you connect, and it should ring her phone. So
this is Shree.
All right. Shree, go ahead.
So what I'm getting is it says no one is in the group. I get an error message. And the second question I had is, if my wife signs up in part of that group, then is she also a volunteer then to take other calls?
This is Kenny.
Kenny, go ahead.
Yes. She'll be in your group and so forth, but she'll also take other calls at this time. And I guess Be My Eyes said they had no way to kind of differentiate. You know, that's just how it's set up. Which is kind of turned people off from that because the people did not want to get the calls from the strangers. They just wanted to help the family members.
This is Shree. Can she refuse taking a call?
She does not have to answer the call, and it will go to somebody else, but she might get other calls.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right.
This is Herbie.
Go ahead, Herbie.
Okay, curiosity question. What's the advantage of having a family member in Be My Eyes as opposed to just, say, like using FaceTime video? Assuming, of course, you know, it's not a situation where one's an Android user or whatever. That's...
Mm-hmm. Sure. All right. Does anyone have any thoughts? Maybe Shree, since you're setting that up.
This is Shree. I was thinking more like, you know, I'm just using my wife as an example, but you can always invite somebody outside that, like you said, may not have an iPhone.
Mm-hmm, for the cross-platform aspect.
Right. Okay.
Okay. All right. Well, very good. Hope that is a bit helpful in getting John. That set up. John, go ahead.
So I just wanted to offer a counterpart just to kind of agree with what Herbie was saying, is that just as a friendly reminder to people, if you're on iOS 18, like I had the pleasure of using this share screen and share remote access with FaceTime. And it was a big help because a sighted tech friend of mine was helping me troubleshoot a problem with So the Institute for the Blind, they use exchange mail that apparently in their terms of service, they can basically control and dictate the terms of how my device is being used. And I ran into certain issues where I couldn't do certain things. But where I'm going with this is that unlike Be My Eyes, I like with FaceTime because I have the option to share my screen or give remote access. So I don't know if it works with voiceover users on both ends, but if for someone who's getting help from a sighted person, it's a big help because we're no longer restricted to just computer users.
All right. Very good. Thank you for sharing that. Yes, that is a recent enhancement and finally a good one after being only limited to view only access with third party sharing apps before.
This is done.
One moment. I think I heard, who did I hear? Was that Jody? I think he was first. Yep. Sorry. No worries.
Just as a quick comment, if you have a friend that is sad for them that they have an Android, you can use Google Duo, and that'll give you the same options as FaceTime video with an Android user.
All right. Very good. All right. We're going to do, I think it was Pete and then Dot, and then we'll reach our halftime show.
Yeah. I was just wondering, John, which were you saying enabled or allowed you to share your screen and allowed the other person to remote into your phone? Was that the FaceTime feature?
Oh, sorry. This is John.
Yep. Go ahead, John. Yep.
So I don't have firsthand experience with the in terms of initiating it, but it was my understanding that. My understanding that it fell under the share play option. So, but yeah, there's option to share your screen or share your video. There are a few quirks.
FaceTime, this is.
FaceTime, yes.
Because we were also talking about Be My Eyes, Be My Eyes.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, so this is the FaceTime feature.
FaceTime,
okay, that's all I was asking. Thank you, John.
All right, thank you. And then Dot will take your comment on this, and then we will shift.
Okay. About the cross platform, you can also use Messenger, Facebook Messenger across platform. You don't need to have an iPhone to use that.
All right.
Facebook Messenger will do the trick.
Absolutely. All right. Deborah. Very good. So lots of different. All right, Deborah, if it's on this and in a minute or so, go ahead.
Okay. I haven't used it yet, but I've heard that RIM, Remote Incident Manager, is really good for that, and it's so good that Ira uses it now.
So that may, I'm not sure if that's available. I don't believe that's available on iOS at the moment.
Yeah, this is Herbie.
I think it is.
All right. Yes, go ahead, Herbie. Is it?
No, I've not heard of RIM being available for iOS, but I did also want to mention that you can also generate a FaceTime link, and anybody can use FaceTime that you give the link to. So just wanted to remind people of that function as well, of FaceTime.
All right, very good. Well, thank you all. Great discussion about receiving remote assistance in a lot of different ways, some of which are just new and expanding. And on that exciting note, it is time. So in our announcements, I did not mention, because we're going to mention it now, that on Fridays, including this Friday, we're going to have our iBUG night at the virtual movies. And it is now time for our exciting halftime show, where we will have the big reveal as to what movie we will be watching this Friday. So with that, Mr. McCulloch, are you ready? It's my party and I'll cry if I want to cry. If I want to cry, if I want to cry. You would cry too if it happened to you.
Leslie.
Yes. I am back.
Quincy Jones song.
Do we want to see who maybe, let me just give a shout out to the late, great Quincy Jones, who wrote that for
Leslie. Yeah.
What sad.
Wow.
So, anyway.
Yeah. Big love. Big
maybe
loss.
We want to recognize, loss. Acknowledge who's here. That didn't get
who has not gotten to introduce themselves yet. Yes, in our
Pete
first hour. Go ahead, Pete. Or welcome, Pete. Excuse me.
Thank you.
You did go ahead.
This is Desi in Franklin, Tennessee. Oh, sorry.
Dot and Desi, welcome.
Hi.
Anyone else who joined us after the first round of intros?
Shree from Virginia.
Hey, Shree, welcome.
Vincent in New Jersey.
Hey, welcome, Vincent. Thank
you. Jerry from Vermont.
Hello, welcome.
Jerry from Vermont.
Welcome, Jerry.
Deborah from Houston.
Hey, welcome. All right.
Terry from Arlington Heights.
Terry, welcome. Anyone else?
From Chicago.
All right, welcome. All right, and
Amanda from California.
Welcome, Amanda.
Thanks.
All right, anyone else? All right. Well, welcome to you all. And thank you, Mr. McCulloch. Now we'll turn it back over to you for the big reveal.
All right. Thank you, Maria. Sounds like we got a lot of great players out there, big crowd tonight. So get ready for that. But before we get going into that, we got to make sure people have your background noise off. We had been going over uses for WD-40, and I'm going to finish it tonight with two more for you. All right. How about anybody have water spots on their mirrors or on glass? Well, squirt a little WD-40 on a rag, wipe that down, and you will have a sparkling clean mirror or glass with no streaks. You won't believe it.
Mirror is no use for me.
And then also, what about your toilet bowl? Sometimes there's rings left by various kinds of sediment deposits and whatnot after it's been sitting there a while. You can just squirt. Well, first you got to drain the water out, turn the water off, and then squirt some on around that ring. Let it sit for about 30 seconds and then take a rag and wipe it down and then fill the water back up in your toilet and start flushing a couple of times and you will have a brand spanking new looking toilet bowl. All right. So WD-40, who knew what all it could do?
Exciting.
All right, now we are going to get into You Know It.
Here he goes.
Come back.
Mr. McCullough.
I think he got spirited away.
I think so.
Okay, we got rules, you guys. To stay unmuted. Everybody gets to stay unmuted. We want everyone to play. We got how many people in here? 49.
49.
So we want everyone to play. We want some new people to play, too. There are going to be 5 clues. You get 1 guess per clue. If you were a winner in the last 3 weeks, you are not eligible tonight. You can still play. Well, no, you can't play. Sorry. Then what's the other rule? I keep forgetting. There's one other rule.
If you've won in the past 3 weeks.
Right.
Oh, I thought I just said that. Okay. Well, maybe I didn't. I just thought it in my head. All right. People were talking in my head. Okay. So anyway, so let's put the rules. So, you got to say your name and wait to be acknowledged, just like in the regular program. So we want to make sure we do that. Everybody, please. Okay. Let's go to clue number one. All right. Last week, the film was set on the West Coast. This week, guess what? It's on the East Coast. Ooh. Except it's the East Coast of Africa.
Rahil?
Rahil!
What about the title, Africa? Because I know there's a song called Africa by Toto.
Well, we are looking for a movie, Rahil, but we will say there's not a movie that we know of called Africa. There's Out of Africa. Maybe that's what you're thinking of, but Anyway, that's not it either. But
thanks. I wanted to guess this out of Africa.
Anybody else?
This is Dot.
Dot.
There's a movie called God Must Be Crazy.
The gods must be crazy.
It's in Africa.
Yes. No. Good try, Dot.
Nice try, Dot.
Brooks.
How about Madagascar?
Madagascar is off the west coast of Africa, but not the one we're going to watch this week. Good try. All right, we're going to move on. Clue number two. The film uses handheld cameras to create a documentary-like effect. Handheld cameras are used to give it a documentary-like feel or effect.
Raheel?
Raheel.
What about the title of the movie called Effect?
Effect. Okay. I've never heard of it, so we will not play it this week. Good try, Raheel. Anybody else before we move on?
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Jerry from Vermont.
Hotel Rwanda. Rwanda?
Hotel Rwanda. Oh, Jerry. He's getting serious.
Oh, yeah. We don't fool around
here.
That
is a very serious movie. And I think we've already played that one, so we will have to say not this time. Good try, Jerry. All right, moving on. Clue number three. The film's tagline is out here, survival is everything. The tagline is out here, survival is everything.
This is Dot.
This is Shree.
Dot.
Blood Diamond.
Ooh, boy, you guys are coming up some great movies.
No way.
All right. Dot, we are going to have to go to the judges on this one. That was the way you said that could be a little contentious. Say it one more time.
Blood Diamond.
Blood Diamonds. Okay, got it. Yes. No. He said Blood Diamonds.
I think it's just one diamond.
Diamonds.
He said, yeah, diamonds with an S.
With an S. Blood Diamonds. That's the title of the movie, Blood Diamonds.
Okay, Dot, the judges have ruled, and they have come to the conclusion that...
Ding, ding, ding.
He's guilty.
Not this time, Doc. Good try. Close.
Sounds like it was close.
This is Shree.
Okay. Shree's up next.
Lion King.
Lion King.
Aww.
Have we ever shown any animated movies?
No, they have live action of it now.
Oh, circle there he is. Okay.
I'd like to be king.
Oh. Yeah.
There you go, Dot.
Oh, there's yeah. First time for everything.
The Lion King.
Simba.
Yeah.
Simba.
Yeah. Okay. If Shree can sing three lines out of the movie, we will see how the answer is.
Come on, three, go, three.
Come on, three.
Don't
let it rip.
Anybody wants to help him,
I'll play guitar for you. I'll play guitar for you. Three.
I have no idea.
All right, Dot, give him three lines of a song.
Go, Dot.
What is that? Is that? Gonna love this all tonight. De-da-de-da-da.
Feel the love tonight.
Can't you see the love
tonight? Gonna be a mighty king. So enemies.
There you go.
Yeah, Herb.
Oh, yeah, all right, Herb. Coming in.
Yeah.
Yeah. iBug's Got Talent right here.
Yes, tonight. We are trying out for iBug's Got Talent.
Hakuna Matata.
Guys are qualified.
I just can't wait.
The movie is incorrect. Not tonight. Not this week. Not anytime.
All that for nothing. You let us on, Michael.
All right, moving on to clue number four.
Brooks.
Oh, Brooks.
How about Black Hawk Down?
Black Hawk Down. Oh, another
is that in Africa?
Movie.
Ooh, that's a good. Yeah, that's in Somalia, which is in East Africa. Oh, yes. So, ooh.
Somalia, the
country.
Somalia
of
was it? Maria?
Somalia.
Yeah.
Bruce is getting so warm.
Wow.
He's almost sizzling here.
Sounds good, Brooks.
Sizzling. No.
We're hearing a touch of a ding.
Poor Mr. McCullough. He sounds like he's in agony.
He is. He goes through every Monday night.
Good try, Bruce.
A recurring ailment every Monday Brooks. Night.
All right, we're going to move on.
Four. We're on clue number four.
You got to speed this up. All right. Some of the actors underwent extensive boat training.
Ooh.
What?
Boat.
This is Desi.
Boat training. Desi.
Desi's got it.
Well, I don't know if I really do, and this is really an old movie, but I was thinking of African Queen.
Ho 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 ho
right here.
What?
Right here.
What
is actually on the West Coast, but we're almost gonna give it to Desi on another night.
Thanks.
Good try, Desi. All right, I heard Raheel and then Pete. Go, Raheel.
I was going to say boat training.
Boat training.
That's what? The title, too?
That has to be a real title, Raheel.
All right. Good try, Raheel. It helps if you don't just repeat the clues. But good try. All right. Go ahead, Pete.
I was going to say Captain Phillips.
Captain
Ooh.
Phillips.
Wow.
Oh.
Good one.
That one.
Boat
that
thing.
It's got a boat.
It's got a boat.
Like a boat.
Oh. Lots of boats. Big
off
boats.
The eastern coast of
Africa.
Yeah, it's Somalia, isn't
That's
it?
Somalia.
Wow.
Yeah.
We're down that way.
The Somalian pirates.
Well. You know what?
Too far off the coast,
huh? You know what? Ding, 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 ding! Got it! Captain Phillips, Tom Hanks!
Oh, Captain what?
Good job, Pete! Captain Phillips!
That's the true story.
No it is!
Captain Robert Phillips, based on a true story of his book. A captain's duty. Richard Phillips. Yes. Great
Very
movie.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that one.
That'll
be great.
Be there Friday night.
Well, what's Pete's prize, Mr. McCulloch?
Yeah, come on there, buddy.
It's gonna be
Somebody's house.
There's one
right
scene.
Here
at
this big house.
There's one scene where
the
pirates are
get on the side since you're already on.
Up oh, one second.
Somebody's
Let's
talking
just,
in the background.
Yep, we're gonna just take care of that. Lee,
okay.
Thank you, Julie.
Very good. Okay, so there's a scene in the movie where the Somalian pirates, after they've come aboard the ship and they've captured Captain Phillips and taken him hostage, and then they jump into a lifeboat and start escaping. Mm-hmm. And so we got the...
The lifeboat?
Paddle.
Well,
a surprise.
It's a 1/200th scale... of that lifeboat.
Right. That I can play with in my tubby.
Yes, made of rubber, suitable for your bathtub. And of course, it's
right. Is it an iBUG color?
In black color. So,
of course.
All right.
Congratulations, Tree.
I just want to make the comment that I want to make the comment that Captain Phillips is from Vermont. I just
of course. All real men are, right?
Do the Navy SEALs come from Virginia?
Even you and him are about the only two
thanks
people
everybody
from
for playing. Right. I must be departing, sadly to say.
I wonder if the, night, will the boat float in my Calgon beads?
We'll see you next week.
Thank you, Mr. McCullough.
Good night, Mr. All right. Thank you, Mr. McCulloch. So with that, we are going to shift now to our iBUG Byte. And for today's iBUG Byte, we're going to be talking about a new feat. We've been talking about iOS 18.1, and we're going to be hearing about one of the new other new features in iOS 18.1.
Are you ready?
I am.
Here we go.
A new feature in iOS 18.1 is the ability to record phone calls and to then play those back with transcription being automatically provided as well in the Notes app. If you are on a call with another person, both will receive a notification that the call is being recorded. I'm going to make a call now to an automated service to show how this works. When I do that and when the call connects, there will be a record call button that appears on the screen. I'm going to make a call to UPS.
One call plus one phone call. Hi, keypad.
I'm hiding the keypad.
Keypad button.
And I'm going to select
start call recording button.
Start call recording.
I didn't catch that. Your account number is 6 characters. Tell it to me one character at a time, or say, I don't have one.
I don't have one.
Okay. How can I help you today?
Shipping rates.
Okay, rates. You can find the most accurate rates and delivery times online by logging into your UPS account. Now, are you shipping within the U.S.?
Yes.
What's the starting zip code?
And I have now ended this call, and we're going to go into the Notes app.
Notes, folders, back button.
This call recording will appear in my iCloud Notes folder, which is the one that I am currently in. But if I back out of this,
Notes, edit button,
and I flick to the right several times, I will now see a new folder.
Sir, dictate call recordings, OneNote button.
Specific to call recordings, which has now appeared since I have a call recording. We'll go into that for ease of reference.
Selected call recordings, OneNote. Selected folders, back button.
And I'll go back up to the top of the screen with a four-finger tap in the upper half just to clear the focus. And if I continue to flick to the right.
Today, heading, call recording, modified 8:08 p.m., one audio recording, in folder notes. Actions available.
So this call recordings folder consolidates your call recordings regardless of where they are located. It's a kind of a reference point. As you heard there, I was told that the call recording's actual location is the notes folder in my iCloud account. If I double tap here.
Note, call recording. Call recording, 8:07 p.m. Audio attachment, 37 seconds. Text field. Actions available.
And we'll just flick to the right.
Call recording, 8:07 p.m. Audio attachment, 37 seconds, button. Toolbar, checklist, off, button.
And here we have the regular toolbar for notes. So we will flick back to the left to the button for our audio attachment and double tap.
Call sheet grabber button.
And we'll flick to the right.
Call recording heading today, 8:07 p.m. 37 seconds.
I'm just continuously flicking to the right.
More button, pop-up button. Participant button. I didn't catch that. Your account number is 6 characters. Tell it to me one character at a time or say I don't have one. Go ahead. But you button.
So you see here, as I'm flicking to the right now, there are these buttons and it is differentiating between participant as it's calling the UPS call because I don't have that in my contacts and me.
I don't have one button.
And if I double tap on this button, I don't have one.
Notes, sheet grabber, button.
Okay. How can I help you today?
Shipping rates.
Okay, rates. You can find the most accurate rates and delivery.
As you can hear, that is a quite clear audio quality, despite the fact that the call was recorded at quite a lower volume relative to the sound of VoiceOver on my phone. And double tapping on that one button of the call segment took me to that place in the recording. So it started me from where I double tapped, and then it just kept playing the recording until the end of it, or until I paused it as I did there. So what this screen looks like if you were to keep flicking to the right is that it will keep taking you like this between segments of the call. So between each speaker and what they say, and then the next speaker, what they say, and so on. And then let's take a look after you reach the final part of the call. So I'm here right at the bottom of the call. If I flick to the right,
what's the starting zip code button?
That was the very last portion that I recorded from the UPS participant asking for that starting zip code. That was after which I hung up the call. And if we just keep flicking to the right,
26.38 seconds.
We have a time marker there as to where we are in the recording.
Go backward 15 seconds, button. Play, button. Go forward 15 seconds, button. Hide transcript, button. Done, button.
And there we have our transport controls, that ability to hide the transcript if you just want more of a clutter-free interface with which to be able to play the audio. And of course, the done button will take us out of the screen and back into our call recordings folder, since that is the last place we were.
Notes, call recordings, back button.
And that is the new call recording feature in iOS 18.1. Thank you, Brad, for playing that. And I'm happy to take any questions.
This is Desi.
Desi, go ahead.
Okay, so I thought that when you were recording a call, a message had to go out to the other person and they had to accept that you were recording it. And is the reason that didn't happen because this was an automated system?
Yeah, so to my knowledge, and that is a good question, and I haven't tried this yet with a non-automated call, but to my knowledge is that the message will come up, but I am not, I don't believe that the other person actually has to accept it. If anyone else has tried to record, oh, I think I heard Herbie
first.
This is
Rahil.
Okay, well,
so correct. You are correct in a non-automated call. You, both people hear the notification, and that's it.
That's it. Yeah, they don't have to consent.
Okay, they don't have to accept it. They could just, if they don't want you to record them, I guess they would just hang up.
They would hang up.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep, similar to in customer service situations where you get the notification, this call may be recorded. And so if you don't want that, then don't proceed kind of a thing. So, all right.
Thanks.
All right. Yes, good question. All right, Kenny, did you have anything to add there, or was it the same?
Yes, I do. You can also record FaceTime audio calls as well.
Very good. And I assume the same thing would happen in terms of what was just Herbie just described. You'd get the notification and...
Yep, that it'll say this call is being recorded. Yes.
All right. Very good. All right, Raheel, I think you had a question.
Is there a time that I would have to use that feature to record a phone call? Or because I know whenever I get a scam call, they like to record and all that. And that's why I'm like, you know, I don't want to be recorded or anything, but is there a time that I would have to use the record feature, or like, why did Apple decide to include that?
Well, you know, I'm not, it's definitely up to you as to whether you're in a situation where you want to use it or not. There have been a lot of requests for such a feature. There'd been a lot of third-party apps which had tried to work around the lack of recording. And so Apple did finally add it. You know, there might be situations where you may want to use it. For example, if you're calling a customer service to make some kind of a complaint or regarding tech support, and you want to make sure you have the case information, or you want to take down the fact that, you know, a person have a record of a person saying, you know, we'll get back to you in 2 weeks or something. And then if they don't get back to you, you know, you have some documentation. So you may wish to, or you may not, just depending on your use case. But you definitely, you know, you have the option there to start the recording. But of course, you know, you don't have to do it if you're not comfortable with it. So it's an option.
All right, Joe. Star two, if you call star.
One second. Whichever situation you might find yourself that you might want to have a recording, you're free to use that feature. So, all right, Joe, I think you are next.
Yeah, one case I would use it is if you are having an appointment being made. And especially I've noticed if you're getting a report, if you're going to a hospital to see a specialist, they have all kinds of instructions, and that would be perfect for that.
All right. Very good. Thank you for that. And yes, appointment of any kind, whether it's a paratransit or a doctor or any kind possibly. Yes. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Herbie.
Just one other example I can think of where it can really come in handy. In fact, Chanel ran into a situation with this where I suggested that it's too bad you didn't think of the recording feature, is you get called by, you know, a medical company or whatever that provides you services, and you have to be the one to repeat information to your doctor's office. So that recording, you know, if you make a recording of the phone call, then you have... It automatically transcribes right in front of you what you need to say to your doctor's office, what they said. So,
all right. Very good. Thank you for that. So, yeah, lots of potential good use cases for this. All right. Any other questions on the... Yes, go ahead, Jody.
Well, you're the perfect person to ask the legality of this.
Well, certainly.
You want to comment on that one?
Well, with the disclaimer that iBUG does not provide legal advice, different states, do have different requirements. We certainly urge you to check whether your state is a single party consent state or a two party consent state.
That's what I was wondering. Yeah.
That will determine that. So we suggest that you proceed under the require we compl- that we suggest that you comply with the legal requirements of your state.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Jen. That is a very good point. Good thing to bring out. I think I heard John next.
And Pete.
Yeah.
And then Pete.
In light of that, I was wondering if this may be an unprecedented scenario, but I'm wondering if iBUG may consider using this for their mentoring program for the people who are learning their iDevices.
All right. That is definitely an interesting topic. And yeah, all right, go ahead, Herbie.
Two thoughts on that, just real quick. First of all, sure. I mean, you can share the recordings, so it's definitely possible, but you'd have to show the other person how to use it. I will tell you, though, real quickly, like, And I you know, it's not a bad idea. I will tell you my experience. A lot of people, when I did the mentoring thing, just always had their phone on speakerphone and used like a separate recorder to record the conversation anyway. So, but it's not, I mean, it's not a bad idea. I just don't know if it can be, I know it can be shared. Now, can it be saved as like an actual MP3 or file that can be played in an external player? That I'm not completely sure about.
Right. Yeah. I know under that more option, there is the more button, for example, in the note. I mean, it appears just like any other, you know, note. So yes, it can be shared, but I haven't played with that as well as to whether it can be saved. Typically what it's done in the mentoring program is that the mentor has two devices. For example, if a mentor and mentee meet on a Zoom call, which the mentee can also dial in as a phone number if need be, then there's a Zoom recording and then that gets shared with the mentee. But certainly good, you know, good thoughts, always thinking about ways to improve the process. So thank you for that. Pete, you are next, and then we'll go to Shri.
Yeah, and forgive me, Maria, I missed a piece of your presentation there. Is there a way to play the entire recording from start to finish without playing the transcript part?
Yes, that's a good question. Yes, so at the bottom of the screen, so after the transcript, or you can also, there's a hide transcript button if you want to just have a clutter free, along the bottom are those transport controls that go back a certain, I think it's 15 seconds, the play, the go forward and so on. The transcript just allows you to start the playback from that specific point. Mm-hmm. But yes, yeah, certainly you can just play it all the way through.
Good. Thank you.
All right, very good. Shri.
Yeah, I was going to say, just, you know, as a joke, I call myself and I record a call and I cuss myself out. And transcribe everything I said.
What? Oh, my goodness.
So I think, you know, actually, it's actually good that it
we
does that.
Because, hear that,
you
know,
you could have a call that's very abusive and you can get a good transcription of it.
As long as you remember to start that record button. But hopefully none of us will find ourselves in such a dire situation. But it is a good thing to know. Yes.
We're shocked that Shri did.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
It doesn't happen in real life. I just wanted to test it.
Yeah, we know.
Glad
to hear it. Glad to hear it. All right. Herbie, and then I think we can shift from this.
So, Shri, my question for you, that's all great and fancy that, you know, you called yourself and cursed yourself out and all that, but what if you call yourself back?
I'd be very polite.
Oh, my goodness. All right. Well, on that note. Oh, yeah. Yes, go ahead, Pat.
Okay. I've noticed when I'm making calls, it'll say something, start recording, and it says dim. Why is it doing that?
Are you talking about this call scenario that when you're in the keypad, when you've hit in the keypad and the recording option is dimmed?
I don't know. If I'm making a call, it'll say recording dim or something.
Right, so you're on a phone call. Okay, have you hidden? Oh, I'm sorry. I see what you're saying. So the reason, okay, I understand what you're saying. So it's going to say that until the other. One moment, we're just getting some background noise. Yes, exactly. Until the service or what have you answers it, whether it's the automated or the other person on the line. That's correct. It will be dimmed until that happens. All right. Very good. All right.
This
very good. Anyone? Yes, Pete, go ahead.
Yeah. Last question. Or
sure.
A quick question, I hope. I think I know what Pat's talking about. When I got an incoming call earlier today from a solicitor and my phone screen said potentials, was it say scam or potential?
Or spam or something.
Yeah, something. Yeah, like that. The top of the screen had record this call and it was dimmed. So from the outset, I'm wondering if there's a setting in your settings app that you need to go into in your phone settings to enable this feature.
But I guess back to what I just said with Pat, like you didn't answer the call, correct?
Well, I did, but I couldn't. I tapped on that button and it didn't do anything. The record button at the top.
Plus a button.
Oh, interesting. All right.
This is Desi.
Yes, go ahead, Desi.
My understanding is that you do have to turn, because I heard an AppleViz thing that Thomas Domville did on this, and you do have to turn call recording on in settings before
all it will right
work. This is Paul.
Probably in your phone settings.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Desi. Go ahead, Paul.
Well, actually, mine was on when I upgraded the to 18.1. I was on the phone, actually, called Terry. We were talking, and this record call thing came up, and we said, what the heck is that? So it got switched on. Had to go in and manually turn it off. So.
All right. Thank you for that. Yeah, certainly that's a good point to check your settings after the upgrade. I will say, for example, and I saw this on Apple Viz happen to others, my Braille screen input gesture to enable Braille screen input got turned off, for example. So definitely if the phone is not behaving as expected with some of these, you know, new or existing settings, do check them out after the update. You may have to readjust them. All right. Very good. Thank you all for the good discussion on the call recording. So now we will go on to our next question. So who would like to ask a new question on a new topic? Perhaps someone who hasn't asked a question yet.
This is Terry.
Or who would like to make a comment. Terry, go ahead.
A follow-up from my toys segment from last week. You guys were correct. If you want to use another person's camera on a phone call to help identify something or help you to find something, using the camera on your Ray-Ban Meta smart glasses, you have to initiate the call in WhatsApp. And there is some steps that you follow to do that. And so perhaps at another point time somewhere along the way, I can demonstrate what you do, because now I know how to do it and how to make it work. And I got my glasses to work. Carla and I worked on this yesterday, and it works really well, but it is through WhatsApp.
This is John.
All right. Go ahead, John.
So just to let everyone know, if you've been listening to Double Tap with Stephen and Sean, they did it. They did have Janine Stanley from Ira on the show. And she did say that the Ira function is now moved from private beta to public beta. She's also said that the reason why the process for making this a simple, straightforward process, it, unlike with Be My Eyes, is because she stated that because Mike Buckley is more connected with, I think he knew people who worked for Facebook and had good connections, that's kind of part of why it was a smoother transition with Be My Eyes than it is with Ira. So that's why they're kind of still working to move the process along on in terms of Ira. So this, if people want to review that, they can listen to Double Tap.
All right. Go ahead, Terry.
What I'm talking about has nothing to do with Ira or Be My Eyes. I'm talking about, let's say, John, that I can do a video FaceTime call to you. And when you answer the call, then there are other steps that I can take to initiate to transfer the video of my phone to my glasses, and then you're able to use your phone, the video that comes through on your phone from my glasses, not my phone, but from my glasses, to tell me what my glasses camera is seeing. So that's a whole different scenario altogether, is what I'm referring to.
This is Desi.
I mistakenly last week said that it was with a regular phone call, but of course, clearly it's not.
All right. Thank you for that clarification. Who was that, Desi?
Yes. I was just going to say that that WhatsApp is not your only choice. You can also make calls and do that through Facebook Messenger. That's all the right other option. You can do it all through either one.
Right.
Very good. All right. Thank you for that.
This is Deborah. All
right. Deborah, go ahead.
There was also another demo on Double Tap where a guy was out walking up to a shopping area, and he called his wife, I believe, and she could see, like, what was it, Pat? What Pat was talking about. She could see what his glasses were seeing, and she could direct him to the door of the shop he wanted to go into. She directed him across the parking lot up to the shop door. And
yeah,
okay. That was amazing. So if you get lost somewhere, someone can see where you are and get you out of there.
Right. Yes, absolutely. So yeah, that's what Terry was mentioning last week, but she was just correcting to say that the way you accomplish that is through WhatsApp or Facebook Messenger. Yeah, so absolutely. No, that is a very helpful for sure feature of the glasses for us. And that's what John was mentioning as well, that through Ira, using the WhatsApp integration, that is an option as well if you have Ira access or if you have a paid Ira plan. And I know Ira has said, I believe on their website, there's some material about this integration, and there is some kind of a form or a template, excuse me, it's a template that you can use to, and there's a contact page that's linked it there, and you can contact Meta, who's the company that makes the glasses, with that form template. And hopefully the more people that they hear from, hopefully more likely it is that the integration would be a bit, easier rather than using the WhatsApp as an intermediary. But for now, we do have this option with WhatsApp. Yes, go ahead, Brad.
Yeah, this has been a feature with the Envision glasses for a long time, as long as they've been around, as far as I know. They used to call it Ally. They had to change the name because they got another app that they're calling Ally, and now they call it Call a Companion. So.
Uh-huh. Yes, there. Yeah, Ira. Are we talking about Ira? Oh, no, I'm sorry. You're talking about calling the family.
Yeah.
Yes, but you're talking about, again, calling the family member or someone.
Yeah, well, you set it up. You can have more than one person.
Mm-hmm.
And then they use the camera in the Envision glasses. It's pretty neat.
Yeah. Very good. Well, it's great to have options for sure. And you set that up via the app that comes with them, or the Envision app, excuse me, just the regular Envision app. Very good. All right. Who'd like to ask the next question?
This is Shree.
All right. I heard Shree first.
Yeah. I was wondering, has anyone else experienced this issue where you ask SIRI to find an app on the App Store?
Okay. And what's the issue that happens when you...
It doesn't open up. I don't fit the App Store at all.
Uh-huh. All right.
This is Terry.
Terry, go ahead.
I think I've done it since I upgraded to 18.1, and I think it did open the App Store. I'm sure I have.
All right. And did you use that type of syntax, like what Shri was saying? Like, did you say find whatever, or did you say open, or do you what recall?
This is Terry. What I said was open, because sometimes I think I have the app downloaded and I don't, so mm-hmm. I always say open whatever the app is that I want to open, and it'll say, it looks like you don't have this app on your phone, but we can get it from the App Store. And then it does indeed open the App Store for me, and it puts me right at the that particular app that it thinks that I want to open.
All right. Very good. Well, so Shri, maybe the magic word then is to say open, and hopefully that'll work out for you instead of the find.
Great. Thanks.
All right. Very good. I did hear someone else, but I didn't catch who that was. If someone was trying to jump in.
I think it was John.
Recently.
Yeah.
I think it was John. All right. Go ahead, John. Thank you all. All right. Perhaps
John.
Not. Yes. Go ahead, John.
So I just tested it, and I think was it Terry who was saying, I think yes, it's in the phrasing, because when I tried search for it, it just
it did something weird. It just brought up my Siri screen. And when I did the scrub gesture, it just brought me back to my home screen. But when I said, I think I said get, like if I said get be my eyes from the app store, it like opened it up and brought me in there. So I think it, sure. I think it's being picky about the phrasing.
All right. All right. Very good. So you have options there, Shri. So, right. All right. Very good. Who would like to ask the next question?
It's Joe. I got a comment.
All right, Joe, go ahead.
Siri should be the one called Picky Bot.
Oh, indeed. There are the improvements with the AI coming, but still not not quite there in some ways. Yeah. All right.
Who?
Yes, go ahead, John.
I have a comment and an app recommendation. So if any of you use Microsoft OneDrive and you're on iOS 18, I think when I went in the recent updates from in the App Store, it said that Microsoft OneDrive will be ending support for devices using iOS 16. So if you're a OneDrive user with an iPhone or an iPad, just to be aware of that. The other thing I just wanted to mention is that I attended a group like this, but an in-person group, and one of the people there recommended an app called Blind Compass, and it's kind of neat because you can point your phone in a direction, and it tells you which direction in which you're going, you know, be it northeast, south, or west. And let's say you want to cross a street and you want to lock in that direction so you can to see if the compass will help you walk straight. You know, you can, there's a lock-in button and you can lock it in. So, you know, with, of course, the disclaimer that I'm not an O&M instructor and I'm not, you know, I'm not saying that the app is perfect, but I just thought I'd mention it as an alternative to some of these things like OCO to give it a try.
All right. Thank you for that. And can you clarify, because there is the built-in Compass app on iOS, but it sounds like the differentiator here is this lock-in mode. So what does that do? If you go away from that direction, does it beep, or does it somehow, you know, try and get you back on track? Have you experienced it?
This is John.
Yes, go ahead.
So I don't have firsthand experience, but with the person who recommended it in the group, there are two different modes. Like you can get different tones. So if you can recognize the tone that it's supposed to make when you're locked into the correct direction, you just have to listen for that tone because it'll have different tones, kind of like when you're using the light detector on Seeing AI. But there's also like, it also gives you verbal feedback. So you can choose if you want the tone or if you want the verbal feedback in terms of it telling you the cardinal direction. So I think I'm going to experiment with this app because I'm just curious to know. And yeah, I know with the traditional compass, like it gives you the different degrees. I can't remember if this one does, but it does give you a few options. Again, as I mentioned, like the verbal feedback and the audio feedback in terms of the different tones.
Sure. Yeah, that is unique with the tones. Well, very good. Good to have, you know, more tools in the toolbox. So thank you for that. Shri, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to follow up with that question. So number one, is there a cost to this app? And second, can this app be used behind other apps?
Like in the background?
John, yeah.
Yep. All right, go ahead, John.
So I haven't tested it enough to know for sure, but as far as I know, it's free because I downloaded and installed it. It just said get, and I don't recall it mentioning any subscription because when I went to the description, it just said Compass for the Blind. It didn't but as always, my recommendation is to scroll through the app information in case I may have overlooked something.
Sure.
This is Joe.
All right. Oh, very good. Joe, go ahead.
I just want to thanks a lot, John, because I'm going to be going tomorrow somewhere, and I'm not that familiar with the, I know what cardinal directions I need to use, and this is going to be awesome because I'm not very good with those.
All right. Very good.
I can test that out tomorrow.
Yeah. To test that out and let us know how it goes. Very good. All right. Who would like to ask our next question or make a next comment?
Bridget.
Oh, I think I heard Bridget first.
Yes, can I ask a question about Bard Mobile?
Sure.
Okay, well, I noticed once I was using it, and it's like I had a bug that was downloaded twice, so I didn't really pay it any attention because I said maybe I made a mistake. But here lately, I've been downloading books about the BD number, or I'll ask about an author, and I noticed I just went through them all, and it's like everything is double, and I was like, I know I didn't make these many mistakes. So that's something new or what?
All right. And you're saying when it's double, or are you saying like as you're flicking through, you're seeing the exact same listing for them? Like each book does typically have one button that's the actual name of the book. And then there's a second button that goes along with it that says more info and then the name of the book. And if you select that, it gives you information about the book. So are you saying though, like you're seeing two sets of those or?
Yes, I just go to the left, I see Harlem, mm-hmm. and then I do it again, it say Harlem again, and then the next book just say Glorious, it says mm-hmm. Glorious again, everything is twice.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, does anyone have any experience? The only thing I could think of is that that second button is that more info button, but it should also say more info before that. So has anyone had any experiences with any oddities in Bard lately of downloads? I think I did see something somewhere, although I couldn't tell you where, but I did see some kind of download. Was it, I don't know if it was a site issue. Anyone have any experience of late? All right. Well, I guess then, Bridget, my recommendation would be maybe to just try when you're listening for it again to see if maybe that second button is the more, if it says, like, for example, you're saying Harlem, and then the second time, if it says more info Harlem, if so, that's expected behavior. But if it doesn't say that, if it just says Harlem each time or Glorious, whichever one, and when you select both of them, if they open the book, like if they're literally doing the exact same thing, then that's that sounds like maybe something to reach out to the Bard folks about. And I know there is a help section Rahil? In the bookshelf, and it gives you the contact info. Yes, go ahead, Rahil.
So you have to, it might be helpful if you could reach out to your library to get more assistance with that too, with the Bard issue as well.
Okay, thank you.
All right, good luck with that. Yes, go ahead, Pete.
I just double check my Bard, and you're right, Maria. First you'll get the title of the book. Like our book club book this month is called The Club, and it lists the club. I'm in the bookshelf, and it says The Club, and then it lists the author's name on that same line. And if I flick to the right, it says More Info, The Club, and it repeats the club and the author's name. So the more info is a separate item, and that gives you a little bit of a summary of the book. But it's definitely preface. It starts with the more info words on that second item. It's not the same button.
All right. Yes.
So,
thank you.
If you're getting the same thing twice without the more info on it, then there's something wrong.
Yep. All right.
I have asked him another question. You said The Club, is that the next iBUG book?
That's
yes,
correct.
It is.
Yes,
it's for this. Sorry, this is Pete.
No, go ahead, Pete.
Yeah, that's the name of the book that we're going to be talking about in the next iBUG Villa Book Club meeting, which is coming up on the 14th, I believe. It's a week from Thursday, 2 weeks from Thursday.
And you wouldn't happen to quickly have the BD number, would you?
I do not offhand. I do invite you to visit the website as well under our events section that is listed there. Let's see.
And the author?
So
108821.
All right, thank you. Pete.
All right, thank you. And the author is Ellery Lloyd.
I'm sorry, 128284. I'm sorry, the number.
108284 is what.
108284.
Thank you, Maria.
And it's The Club by Ellery Lloyd. All right. Thank you, Pete. Yes, teamwork. All right. I did hear someone else wanting to jump in, but I didn't catch who that was.
Amanda.
Amanda, go ahead.
Okay, so I use the screen curtain feature, and I've noticed lately that when I'm on my phone, whether I'm on an app or I'm texting, the screen curtain will flash off. And then I see the bright light of the screen, and then VoiceOver will say screen curtain on, and then it'll turn back on. And it's been happening a lot lately, maybe about 10 times a day. And so I was just wondering if anybody else has experienced this, and I don't know, any suggestions what I can do?
Rahil?
All right. Yes, Rahil, go ahead.
I haven't seen anything about that. Mine never gave me any issues, so I just leave my screen curtain on by doing a three-finger triple tap. And I haven't had any issues with mine.
All right. Has anyone experienced this issue?
This is Terry.
Terry, go ahead.
I have not, but Amanda, have you tried turning screen curtain on, off, and then on intentionally? Or when you updated your phone, have you turned off the phone and then rebooted it? Just hopefully squash some of these bugs that are happening.
Okay, this is Amanda.
Go ahead, Amanda.
Yes, I think I've tried everything.
Yeah, I thought so.
I've turned the screen curtain on, and then I've turned VoiceOver off, and then I've turned off the phone, and I've left it for a while, and then I turn it back on, and then I turn everything back on, the screen curtain and VoiceOver, and then it still does that. So then I'll do one at a time. So then I'll turn the screen curtain on, leave VoiceOver on, and then turn off my phone. So I feel like I've tried everything, and it's still doing that, and it hurts my eyes. I can see the screen. It seems to always get me right when I have the phone up to, you know, I'm looking at it or I'm holding it up, and it just gets me right in the face, and it's just so bright.
This is Liz.
So, go ahead, Liz.
Is there a specific gesture you've done right before the screen curtain goes off?
No, sorry, this is Amanda.
Yes, go ahead, Amanda.
I'm either just swiping, like I'm shopping on Amazon, or I'm texting. I'm on an app and I'm doing something. So I'm not really doing any of the gestures besides swiping to the right and left.
All right. I think I heard, and we're just at the end here. So we'll take a couple more comments, and I think Jody was first.
Yeah. Well, you know, I was gonna suggest you go to your control center and turn your brightness way down to like 10%, so that if the screen curtain does go off, it's not gonna be too much of a shock.
Thank
All
you.
All right, and Shri, go ahead.
I was gonna say the same thing.
All right, very good, woman. All right. Well, thank you all for the excellent discussion and great questions. And thank you, Brad, for playing the bite, and to Mr. McCulloch for the fabulous movie trivia. And then and to all of Julie for being our bouncer. And thank you all for your questions. Yes, go ahead, Pete.
Can I say a quick thanks to those who joined us on Saturday night for the iBUG Unplugged Melodies and Memories program? It was a two-hour program, and we had a really good crowd and a great time, and I just wanted to thank everybody who attended and showed so much enthusiasm. It was a great time. That's
very
all.
Good.
Recorded.
Thank you all for the support. And don't forget that this week we've got the Mac Buzz happening on Tuesday from 5 to 6 p.m. Central. And then on Thursday, we have the Trekkie Talk from 8 to 9:30 p.m. Central. We have the movie night on Friday, as we just heard earlier. We're watching Captain Phillips, a great movie starring Tom Hanks. You can join us from 7:15 p.m. Central for the pre-movie social time, and then at 8 p.m. is when the movie begins. And then on Sunday, we've got the iBUG Cafe to learn all about the Amazon app, and that is from 4 to 5:30 p.m. Central. And so with that, I hope you all have a great night, and do join us after as well. Do stay with us if you would like to for the after buzz. So have a great night, everyone. Thank you.